Hello and welcome to Good Learners. This is Safiya Siddiqui and we're back with another chapter of history which is called as Ruling the Countryside. Here we will talk about how the East India Company managed to expand their profits and how they pressurized the peasants into indigo cultivation. Let's begin. So as we spoke of in the last chapter, the East India Company had been granted to be the Diwan of Bengal. Now, what exactly is a Diwan? So basically, the Mughal administration was divided into Nizamat and Diwani, and Nizamat was in charge of the civil administration, whereas the Diwani was in charge of the revenue administration. So with this, the British got control of the revenue and taxes of the Bengal province. Now, Robert Clive in his painting has described this event as something huge, but sources also say that the event happened in a tent. So that's history as a subject right there for you. Now, as the Diwan, the East India Company became the chief financial administrator. So its job was to administer the land, organize the revenue, which involved managing expenses in an effective manner. Now, let's talk about a revenue for the company. So there are obviously two sides to the story. Let's look at the company's side first. So the company still considered itself as a trader and was still looking for ways to get more money from Bengal. And the need of the hour was to fix up a revenue system so that the flow of the money should not stop. Now, before 1865, cotton and silk from India was bought in exchange of gold and silver from Britain. So now, with the revenue system in place, the company now had enough money to buy the Indian goods with that money. This was the company's side of the story. Now, there's the peasants' side too. So, with such conditions, the economy of Bengal was in crisis. And now, the peasants were asked to sell at very low cost. They were also in debt and could not pay back their loans and money. Production and cultivation both was hit. And there was a terrible famine in 1770 that killed almost 10 million people. So, now with such conditions, it was important for the East India Company to improve the agricultural conditions in Bengal. So now, a new policy of permanent settlement was introduced in 1793. The power was now given to zamindars, who were also known as talukdars and rajas. So they were asked to collect rent from the peasants and then pay a fixed revenue to the East India Company. This again was a profitable bet for the company, क्योंकि चाहे एग्रीकल्चरल कंडीशंस ठीक हो या ना हो, द जमींदार्स वुड हैव टू पे द रेवेन्यू कंपल्सरीली. सो नाउ देयर वर प्रॉब्लम्स विद दिस पॉलिसी टू. नाउ द जमींदार्स स्टॉप्ड इन्वेस्टिंग इन द लैंड बिकॉज दे डिड नॉट हैव द मनी एंड दे वर ऑल्सो मेनली कंसर्न्ड अबाउट द प्रॉफिट दैट दे कुड गेट फ्रॉम द लैंड. द रेवेन्यू वॉज वेरी हाई. लेटर ऑन द रेवेन्यू ऑल्सो बिकेम वेरी हाई एंड हेंस इट बिकेम डिफिकल्ट फॉर देम टू पे बैक. And those who failed to pay back were, the land was evicted from them. The system was very oppressive to the cultivators too. If they couldn't pay the rent, the land was evicted from them too. So the idea of having fixed revenue was not necessarily a good one in the long run. And so Holt McKenzie came up with a new system wherein earlier each zamindar had to pay the revenue, but now they started off by measuring the lands. The productive lands and villages or group of villages were now considered as mahal. So the revenue now had to be paid by the mahal together according to the land that they possessed. Now the village headman was responsible for the revenue and not the zamindar. Soon a new system was also devised which is known as the Munro system. Now Alexander Reed started it on a small scale, but then Thomas Munro expanded the system. Now, in the southern parts of India, the zamindars were low to none. So, according to this system, which is known as Ryotwari, R-Y-O-T-W-A-R-I, Ryotwari, the zamindars did not exist as middlemen, and hence the company and the Ryots. Ryots are the cultivators. Now, they were in direct contact with each other. So, the middleman, the zamindars did not act as middlemen now. The idea behind this was that Munro and Reed both thought that the British should act as paternal figures and help the Ryots cultivate better. But the system did not work. Although started in goodwill, the system later became corrupt. The officials increased the revenue, which the zamindars and the cultivators could not pay, and so they fled their lands. Now the British were smart but greedy people. They thought, why use the land just for revenue when we can use it to grow the crops that Europe requires? So what did they do? They forced the farmers to now cultivate crops like jute, tea, sugarcane, wheat, cotton and rice. So these crops Europe required, right? So they could sell these crops there for better prices. They started large scale farming of these crops and also forced the farmers to cultivate opium and indigo. So now we spoke of how the East India Company started large scale cultivation of cash crops, right? But the focus here is on the crop indigo. So here begins the story of indigo. Now in 13th century, Indian indigo became popular in Italy, France and Britain as a cloth dye. Earlier, they used to depend on woad, which is a crop similar to indigo, but then the cloth dyers preferred indigo due to its rich color and better quality. What did they do? They persuaded the governments to release the bans over indigo import, and by the 18th century, the indigo production in North America and the Caribbean islands also stopped due to some reasons. So now the company had to turn to India to meet the indigo demands. Now due to high demands and India being the sole supplier, the East India Company looked for ways to increase the indigo production. And eventually by the end of the 18th century, Bengal indigo dominated the world market. East India Company officials and commercial agents left their job because they thought investing in indigo market would be more profitable. English and Scotsmen too took loans and invested in the indigo plantation in India. Now let's talk about how indigo was cultivated in India. So there were two main systems, Nij and Riyoti. Let's talk about Nij first. So in this system, the planters produced indigo in the lands that they directly had control over. Now there were problems with the Nij cultivation too. So the first problem was that the planters found it difficult to expand the area under this. The indigo cultivation needed fertile lands and these lands were already densely populated. The second problem was that the labor wasn't easily available. Indigo cultivation required a huge workforce, but the peasants were already busy with rice cultivation. Along with the labor, plow and bullocks were also required on a large scale. But then again, these equipments were in use for rice cultivation, and hence less than 25% of indigo cultivation depended on Nij. Others followed the Riyoti system. Let's talk about it in our next slide. Now under the Riyoti system, indigo cultivation was done by the Riyots, who were the peasants. The planters made the Riyots sign a contract or an agreement. They also sometimes pressurized the village headman to sign a contract on behalf of the Riyots. So after the contract was signed, the Riyots were given cash advances initially. The catch here was that they compulsorily had to grow 25% of their land holdings with indigo. The hard work and labor had to be done by the Riyots. The problem here was that the loan cycle never ended, as the peasants didn't earn enough to clear off their debts. And so the cycle never broke. Sooner or later, the cultivators realized the loops into the system and they united to rebel. Now there were other problems with this system too. Now indigo could only be grown on the most fertile lands and the land could not be used again for rice cultivation. Why so? Because the roots of the indigo plant goes too deep inside the soil, hence exhausting it completely. The cultivators and the zamindars saw the problem with the whole process and the system and united to rebel. Now realizing the problems in the system, thousands of Riyots refused to pay the rent and attacked the indigo factories as a sign of protest. Women joined the rebellion too. They fought with pots and pans. Then the people who worked for the planters were socially boycotted too. Gomastas, who were the men working for planters and came to collect the rent, were beaten up in the village. Even the Lathials, who were men with lathis protecting the planters, were targeted. Riyots felt that they had the support of the zamindars and the village headman, and this only encouraged the protesters. And so finally, zamindars, cultivators, peasants and village headmen mobilized to rebel together. Now, after the revolt of 1857, the British government was being very careful about any other rebellion. They basically did not want their image to be affected, and hence they hopped in to look after the matter. The lieutenant governor and the magistrate visited the villages, and the peasants saw this as support for them, and so the rebellion expanded. The news spread, and intellectuals from Calcutta wrote about this. The government had to do something about this, and so they set up an Indigo Commission in order to settle the rebellion for once and all. The commission held the planters guilty for setting up such an oppressive system. Now, the planters were held guilty and banned from setting up plantation in Bengal. The East India Company then set up its base in Bihar and started oppressing the peasants there too. Now, when Mahatma Gandhi was on a tour to Bihar, peasants convinced him to visit Champaran and looked after the conditions there too. And thus began the Champaran revolt. Now with this, we come to the end of the chapter. If you think that the content was helpful, like, share and comment on the video. Also, subscribe to Good Learners for more.